does is it sort of amalgamates all the it's hard to describe it, but everything goes to the winner here, right? If there's a nearby airport, there is in the case of terrorists, it's accessible most of the year, so it's not reliable for us on an emergency basis, but it's available most of the year. As more and more traffic goes through there, as WestJet and Air Canada hammer it out and fight each other for fares and whatever, there more traffic flows there. Then what happens is the rental car companies all build their, you know, capacity there, and so increasingly those businesses are saying, look, we want to come through Prince Rupert. We actually, when you look at the safety of moving their crews down the highway versus landing in Prince Rupert, that's a safety factor for those industries. They don't want to incur 2 hours of highway driving down the Skeena River, although it's beautiful. They don't want to take the risk with their crews, but they are simply forced to, because with a single flight a day, there's not enough choice in terms of frequency. The market is there. That's the most frustrating part, is the market is there. But without some sort of kick or catalyst, Air Canada and WestJet will deploy their resources fighting each other rather than serving a particular community. And I don't think that policy meets Canada's need, quite frankly.
You mentioned the two big carriers fighting it out in markets where they both see a business case. In really small markets, there isn't likely to be enough traffic to justify having two carriers, to allow two carriers Correct. To coexist and compete. And Correct. So I'm wondering what your ideas might be around how to ensure affordability and to attract those investors to the community. To this all relies on having relatively affordable airfare and reliable airfare and enough frequency. How do you do that in the absence of competition? And what role can the federal government play in that equation?
Well, so, you know, the airfare part is something that is hard. That's hard. But I think a certain amount of minimum service could be a requirement of a license. It could be a requirement. You know, if you're going to operate in British Columbia or in Canada or whatever, there should be some requirement to say you're going to maintain a minimum amount of service in this community, this community, this community. We actually do a fairly good job of holding Air Canada accountable on a regular basis. We will call them up and say, listen, have you looked at your fares out of Prince Rupert? Have you looked at your fares out of Terrace? Why? And they'll do but if you don't keep your eyes on them, they bump them right. This was my frustration, honestly, when I worked for the airline industry. I was then CP Air. We had the highest revenue miles flying in and out of northern communities like Prince Rupert, anywhere in the system. We made more money revenue miles than they did flying to Tokyo or anywhere else. And yet, they would put all their equipment into battling each other between Calgary and Vancouver. And it was like, oh, really? Like, come make some money up here. They can make money here. That's the most frustrating part, is they can make money here. But they're just intent on fighting with each other for market share.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mayor Pond, and thank you, Mr. Bachrach. Next, we have Mr. Sprawl. Mr. Sprawl, the floor is yours. You have 5 minutes, sir.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. My question for Mr. Wright to begin, we've certainly heard, we've just done a study on Lynx Air, the latest low-cost carrier to abandon their project of providing low-cost fares for Canadians, and they cited some of the regulatory burdens and the high fee environment. We've heard previous panels in that study talk about how the federal government treats the aviation sector as a bit of a cash cow, and I'd like to get your feedback on that. I guess I'd first like to, if this information is public or you're willing to share it, the amount that your airport paid in airport rents to the federal government in the last year, for which figures are available.
Sure. Actually, as part of pandemic support, our payments to the federal government were waived essentially for last year, and we'll resume payment this year. For our airport, it's not a sizable amount. It runs to about, I think it's about $55,000, $60,000 a year based on a graduated revenue formula. But when you get into major hubs, it's sizable rent figures for that. And yeah, I mean, we have been asked to operate under a user pay system, and that's what airports have done. That is, they try to collect enough money from passengers and users to fund capital. And there's no getting around it. It does add cost to the system. So, sure. You know, there's a bigger thing at play where, you know, who should be operating airports. I think the current model has a lot of positives in terms of service and capital and infrastructure, and there's a bit of a legacy over 20 years. But I think it's fair to beg the question of who should be operating them, because it does add to the cost for sure.
Right. And what's your current airport improvement fee charge for passengers?
Right, so ours would be in the top 75th percentile in Canada. So ours is currently at $35, and there's a very simple reason for that. We have to spread operating costs across too few passengers. So that's added to the ticket, not unlike the, you know, some of the other charge fees and charges that are there that I know airlines don't like, and we don't like anything that destimulates travel either. Right. But that's a product of trying to finance. I mean, we got an airport here built in 59 for an era that's long past, and we have to finance that based across very few users in a user pay model.
Right. And do you have offhand the amount of grants and contributions you receive directly from the federal government in terms of airport infrastructure funding, or, you know, did they buy you a new snowplow or anything like that last year in terms of, you know, the direct investment from the feds into your operation?
Right. No, there were a suite of measures that happened over the pandemic to sort of carry us through when our business fell off 90%, and we had to stay open for, you know, non-commercial reasons such as, you know, life-saving and medical support and things like that. So I think that amounted to almost $6 to $7 million, and did include for a limited time, national airports like Gander were included in what's called the Airport Capital Assistance Program, you might be familiar with, which is made available to divested airports. Our argument, of course, is it's not enough in that fund. I think it's $40 million, and that hasn't changed in decades. Right. And NASA airports aren't eligible because we're supposed to be self-sufficient.
So they collect about $400 million, and there's a $40 million fund that distributes to everyone. You mentioned as well a review of the foreign ownership limits. Were you referring to what part of the aviation sector were you referring to there? Were you referring to the airports themselves or the airlines? I know we heard some who believe that the limits within the 49% foreign ownership should be lifted to allow maybe one entity to hold that much. Is that what you were referring to, or was there another component there that you were talking about?
No, I was referring to the airlines, and I don't have a strong opinion on one way or another, but I think it's important to have at least a cursory look at it and to see if it would be stimulating. I mean, certainly I joined the rest of Canada and seeing that, you know, the collapse of Lynx Air is poor for Canadians. That's not something anyone wants to see, and ultimately competitive pricing is going to be a function of the level of competition that is in fact profitable. We can't ever expect airlines to operate unprofitably at our airports. It's not like a bricks and mortar investment. They have wings. They don't make money. They fly away. So it's very, very crucial that they're all healthy and have good balance sheets and all that good stuff. I guess the question here today is, how do we work together to ensure that?
Right. Mr. Chair, I can't see your red flag there. How much time do I have left?
You have 45 seconds, Mr. Strahl.
Okay. I'm going to ask Mr. Kendall. We talked about the 737-200 series plane from Boeing, essentially 10 years ago now, being no longer supported for gravel kits. That's obviously the workhorse in the north. What is the anticipated service gap between when that air frame is no longer going to be viable and the new runway materials might come online? Are we looking at a crisis here where we're going to hit a major service gap for the north?
The At this point, there's certainly enough, I won't say enough, but there are runways that have asphalt, and they will operate aircraft that do not have gravel kits. So Iqaluit, Inuvik, Whitehorse, Yellowknife, places of that nature. And cargo will come in there. They'll be offloaded onto aircraft that can go to gravel runways. And it's just that with the pilot shortages and things, and crew hour problems that are existing, flights are reduced and service is reduced. So some of the communities rely on air service 12 months of the year. If you get above 60 degrees latitude, 12 months of the year, everything comes in, passengers, cargo, what have you. So if you're running with an aircraft that carries one quarter of the load of a jet,
thank you, Mr. Kendall.
Four aircraft.
Thank you so much, and thank you, Mr. Strahl. Next, we have Mr. Rogers. Mr. Rogers, the floor is yours. You have 5 minutes, sir.
Thank you, Chair, and welcome to all of our guests today. This study, of course, is, as we say, focused on competition in the airline industry and what that might do in terms of improving services to rural and remote communities. Of course, we all know that the state of the airline industry across the country has been impacted immensely by some of the challenges posed from the COVID period. My questions will be directed to Mr. Wright. Welcome, Reg, for being here today. Thank you. Gander, of course, has been known as the crossroads of the world in a different era. Probably the most important airport in Eastern Canada for a long, extended period of time. And international flights would be in and out of there regularly, refueling and visiting Gander. And, of course, the come-from-away tourism show that now is playing at Gander on a regular basis highlights the 9/11 period, of course, and Gander is well known because of that. So the challenge, of course, Mr. Wright, Reg, that you might want to talk about, and what I want to ask you about today is, I hear constantly from people in central Newfoundland about the difficulty of traveling in and out of Gander because of limited flights, the cost of tickets is astronomical at times. Flying from Halifax to Gander return for over $1,000, for example. The people say to me on a regular basis, we need more competition. We need more competition for Air Canada as they fly in and out of Gander. And kudos to Air Canada for keeping your services alive and keeping the airport operating. So, Reg, what I want you to articulate for this committee is, what are the things that you think needs to be done in Gander for an airport like Gander and for all the regional airports that we're talking about across the country if these airports are to survive and if we are, able to improve the services to the people that you serve and to address the complaints around competition. So what are the things you would suggest to this committee that we include in a report to the federal government that might somehow provide that service?
Yeah, excellent point and questions. I think, a broad assessment of airfares in markets that are considered monopolistic or don't have many of the nation's airlines there would be helpful. I do know in our market there's a host of challenges that you outlined, not the least of which can be pricing. Pricing can be an issue. That said, for the summer, there's some good pricing in the market. And, in a free market, the largest contributor to pricing is not going to be the stage length of the flight or any of those things. It's going to be the level of competition. It's not unlike it's a town with only one grocery store. I'm going to expect the head of lettuce is going to come at a premium. So really, it becomes incumbent on these smaller communities to attract and retain competition in the market, which is really down to consumer preference and choice. And some have been successful, and we have had competition in market too. And I do know when WestJet had a presence here, I think the airfares came down almost 35% Porter has the same effect. But the issue right now is there's too many small airports courting and chasing, you know, carriers with a finite capacity for expansion. And in some cases, too few pilots or airplanes to actually come into new markets. So it very much it's a tricky situation. And I do think it does go back to a point made previously around incentive or subsidy. And that would be a shared effort between perhaps province, country, and airport authority that can help de-risk airlines come to new markets. Because ultimately, a lot of them don't make money in the first year in a new market. And if we can take some of the risk out of it, allow them to build traffic, I think they can become a fixture in market. But certainly that's what needs to happen. If we want to talk about ticket pricing, certainly fees and ancillary things are contributory, but competition is ultimately what will bring down airfare.
Reg, I'm interested as well. You made a comment about a renewed national aviation strategy. Did you want to elaborate a little bit on that?
Yeah, we were talking among peers, and it just seems overdue. I think we keep going back to that biblical age, but some of these policies we view as profound things have happened in travel and aviation and technology over 30 years. And I think as part of any review of competition, looking at, you know, the Blue Skies Agreement in particular informs competition and access to the nation. And those things need updating. And I think it really needs to be sort of a tail-to-nose review of what aviation means and all that, including things like pilot recruitment among young people, all of it. It seems antiquated at this juncture, and I think it would be a great use of our collective time if we got all stakeholders around and articulated a sort of a North Star for what the next 30 years should look like.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Wright, and thank you, Mr. Rogers. Prochainement, nous avons encore une fois, Monsieur Lemire.
Once again, Mr. Lemire, you have 2.5 minutes, sir. Thank you, Chair. I'll continue with Mr. Benedict. The financing of Canada's airports is strongly concentrated in those of the country's large cities, but some of the regional airports play a key role in the economy and in tourism in remote regions. I want to talk about the program for assistance to capital, for airport capital assistance. There have been a number of people who, witnesses who have told us that there's a need to review this in order to strengthen those airports. A program, it was brought in 1995, and over 30 years, it's been $38 million that has not been increased. It remained at the same level, according to the Canadian Airports Council. This funding will be used to refurbish runways, rescue equipment, firefighting equipment, and improvement of security, according to the Canadian Airport Association. We're asking for at least $95 million to improve small airports in the regions. Within Quebec, it would be perhaps, it would have maybe one airport per year. And in order to be able to invest, would that assist your industry and bring down the cost to consumers? Yes, absolutely. And something which people don't realize is that international tourists don't go to remote regions because it's complicated, but an international tourist spends twice as much as a local tourist. So we in Quebec, well, tourists come out of the urban areas and go to the airports. We want to invest in that because the issue is not just the airport, but in the regions we land very well. There's no taxi, no car rental, no shuttle, no buses to go to a destination, unless you have a specific package where the company comes and picks you up. So yes, investing in regional infrastructure is crucial, but we want to remind you that everything that surrounds it, if we want to increase the volume, if we do that, it'll improve things. The mayor of Gaspé came to this committee and made a suggestion to enable the regions to structure things and have obligatory tendering processes for those remote communities. Should we decentralize the management of airports and enable them to negotiate with an airline regarding the operations in a regional airport? Will that help, do you think? To be quite frank, it's not something I have any expertise on. Thank you. That's all my time. Thank you, Mr. Lemire.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Another question for Mayor Pond, just about the price of air travel out of Prince Rupert. I just looked at flights this Friday from Prince Rupert to Vancouver, $594 from Vancouver to Toronto, $625. So the cost of a 1.5 hour flight in a turboprop is approximately the same as a flight across the country that takes 4.5 hours. I'm just wondering if that is relatively normal for what, in terms of what people are paying to fly to Vancouver from Prince Rupert.
Yeah, you're familiar with any coffee conversation, and it sounds very familiar to what I'm hearing from my colleagues on this committee here, is that people compare that, I could have gone to Switzerland for the price of a round trip to Vancouver. Yeah, absolutely.
And because the operation of a municipal airport really depends on airline traffic, both landings and airport improvement fees based on a per passenger basis, how does the current availability of flights, the current service levels, affect the financial viability of the Prince Rupert Airport?
It places the burden on the taxpayer. I mean, we have a life-saving requirement to keep that airport operating, and so that burden that's been shifted over the years from other levels of government down has only one place to land, and that's on the local 12,000 people that are trying to do the Lord's work here on the North Coast in terms of building Canada's great gateway, right? And that's why I think I'm a fan of a lot of what's taken place, but at the margins, we've got to recognize that it is not a great model for how you keep these essential services operating. If it's depending on user fees and traffic, and now you're fighting amongst communities for that traffic, it's a race to the bottom, and in the end, it is not good public policy.
So, Mayor Pond, are you saying that property taxpayers currently have to subsidize the airport operations on account of the low traffic volumes?
Correct. Absolutely. I think we are probably into it for about $1 million a year right now. And I don't even want to think about what would happen if we lose the one remaining flight. And we've seen that. I think when you get to one flight a day, we've seen in other communities that becomes unsustainable, because now you're distributing the cost of operating that airport, across those few users that are available.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bachrach, and thank you, Mayor Pond. Next, we have Mr. Davidson. Mr. Davidson, the floor is yours. 5 minutes, sir.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chair, and I want to thank our witnesses, and especially Mr. Benedict. On behalf of tourism, from coast to coast to coast, and in the great province of Quebec, and obviously the province of Ontario, do you consider it's both the province of Quebec and the federal government's job to, promote tourism?
Je peux répondre en français?
English, or whatever.
Excuse me, Mr. Davidson, I'm going to stop your time there to make sure you didn't lose that wonderful opening that I would love to hear you say again. But, Mr. Benedict, on a des traducteurs,
Mr. Benedict, we have interpretation available. May I answer in French? Absolutely. You may speak in a language of your choice. Thank you. Yes, at the Alliance, we're working in close collaboration with Destination Canada and the federal government. We have a somewhat unique model in Quebec compared to the rest of Canada. In Canada, organizations who promote tourism internationally and their organizations
have limited time. I'm just saying the federal government should be passionate about tourism, the province of Quebec, okay. Passionate about tourism, the passion.
Oui, bien, définitivement. Mais j'essaie de comprendre le sens de question.
Yes, I'm trying to understand your question.
Recently, the Liberal Minister of Health stood up in the House of Commons and said families taking their kids on road trip this summer are, quote, letting the planet burn. And given that the government considers road trips to be unacceptable activities for Canadians, are you concerned that the Liberals also consider trips or vacations taken by Canadians by air to be unacceptable as well? Are those those comments by a Minister of the Crown in the House of Commons concerning to you?
I hadn't heard those comments. We encourage air travel as well as road travel, however we wish to travel these days. That is not an issue. Of course, the tourism issue is really focusing on sustainable development as companies as well, but there are different means of traveling throughout the country in an eco-responsible way.
For my constituents on it, that this was, you know, negative promotion of tourism, negative promotion this summer of getting Canadians out. And this came after Conservatives' opposition plan to give Canadians a break this summer, having the government actually ax the fuel taxes this summer. That would save the average family $670 to be able to come to the province of Quebec. But, you know, again, we heard these comments from the health minister saying if you take a vacation, you're actually letting the planet burn. So those were just concerning comments to me. So I'm glad you're here promoting tourism in Quebec, because I'm sure as heck going to promote tourism right across Canada and hope that people take advantage of air travel to get to our regional airports. And you know what, Mr. Kendall, for those that can afford to do it, I hope we get lots of people up to the Arctic. So over to you, Mr. Kendall. I know the federal government is now decommissioning, I believe, and you correct me if I'm wrong, a number of NDB across Canada. I know you've spoken about, you know, the Arctic's very unique, the Great North is very unique about aircraft that's operating. You know, we still use the Otter, the Beaver. Canadians were leaders in that technology. And, you know, I think we've fallen behind on a lot of this technology, back to the 737-200 not being able to operate on gravel strips once they're decommissioned. There are no replacements. So, you know, I'm wondering about the cost to airlines. Speaking about fleet, you know, not everyone can afford to have a full G1000 panel and shoot GPS approaches. Is the government, you know, their pathway to decommissioning NDBs doing a new VOR sort of highway? Do you think we're falling behind on a lot of things, not getting GPS approaches approved fast enough? You could comment on that.
I cannot comment on that because I don't know the situation.
Okay. No,
I've been out of aviation flying skill for too long.
Okay. Mr. Wright, do you have any comment on us falling behind on technology that and about servicing, you know, older fleets, Mode C, 1900s, that are still flying around Canada that don't have the capabilities?
I'd certainly would like to see the safe lifespan of certain older model aircraft extended. Some of them were great workhorses in the regional market. I don't feel like I am informed enough to understand that where Canada sits vis-a-vis its perhaps neighboring countries in terms of adoption of technology.
Okay. As far as the audit goes then, Mr. Kendall, has there been any closing of airports up there that you're aware of? Flight service stations, for example, FSS?
I'm not aware of that, but I don't believe that airports are closing. They require those services of air services for 12 months of the year, so they're not going to shut down.
Now, as far as the impact, it's all over.
I know the red flag went up, sir. It's very sad.
I know. I know.
Thank you, Mr. Kendall, and thank you, Mr. Davidson. Next, we have Mr. Badaway. Mr. Badaway, the floor is yours. You have 5 minutes, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I do want to, as Mr. Rogers mentioned earlier, drill down on what this study is all about, and that being northern, rural, and remote airports, and of course trying to drill down on further measures for support. The what we're hearing today, but more so is the how. We're going to address a lot of that. We heard from the mayor with respect to leveraging all methods of transportation, albeit road, rail, water. We do recognize that we are embarking on an HFR-HSR project. And with that, recognizing within all methods of transportation the capital investments that are needed. And with that is the operational realities to address the how to the what. That is the financing of same, and then, of course, including the sustainable budget implications that sometimes must include capital debt financing. So we recognize that and respect that, and it all drives toward capacity. Which is part, quite frankly, of the secondary planning of municipalities. It could be water sewer, it could be roads, but in this case, it's airports and methods of transportation. So I guess the second layer to that is going beyond the levels of service and the competition, et cetera, and really looking at the integration of movement of goods and people, connectivity, and then, of course, with that, the strategic investments to meet the outcomes expected. So I guess my first question to the mayor is twofold. One is the supply chain office, and working with them, it's my intent to start a process that will establish a national supply chain and logistics strategy. People, when they hear supply chain, they automatically think of moving goods, but I want to add to that because it's also moving people. And of course, with that is trying to integrate those different methods of transportation to create that fluidity. And then the second part of that, I guess more direct to the mayor, is market studies to de-risk operational and capital budgets. Have there been market studies in your neck of the woods with respect to the need for the services and what specific services are needed with respect to the different levels of transportation? Mr. Mayor?
Thank you. The supply chain piece, I'm not really particularly qualified to answer. To my knowledge, there has not been a significant market study for quite some time in this region, and I think that would be I think that'd be very enlightening. We've had some looks around the edges, but I you know, data-driven decision making is always the best decision making. So that kind of work would be welcome.
And to all the witnesses, we're in a new era of transportation. We're sort of building from the old that's been around in rail's case for a century. But of course, now trying to integrate water, road, and air, which is newer than the rail. And with that, we want to ensure operational excellence. And Mr. Mayor, you hit it right on the head with respect to data-driven decision-making. And of course, investments. So I'm going to go to Mr. Wright and ask him the same questions based on the east end of the country.
Yeah, to your point, we do, you mentioned, you referenced market studies, and that is really the spine of how you make a pitch to an airline for a newer enhanced air service. So we do that recurrently with consultants and internally, and we also quantify the amount of people who live in our market but fly from a neighboring market, as can happen in Prince Rupert, of course. As for the integrity of the supply chain and multimodal, Newfoundland Labrador does not, the island portion does not have TRAN, of course. But we're taking a deep look at that. There's some pretty substantial opportunities. And when it comes to the flow of goods and cargo, you don't need to be in a major urban center to play an active role. So I'm interested to see what's going to happen there in the next coming years.
Thank you, Mr. Wright. Mr. Kendall, same questions.
Same question.
From your perspective in the north end of the country.
Yeah, for the north side of it, again, just air service is you know, basically the Trans-Canada Highway for the north, for the Arctic, and you've got to have it everywhere in the Arctic relies on it. Goods and services are going 12 months of the year, and the pandemic did not affect any of the operations at the airports. If anything, it increased it. So you've got medevac flights coming out of there all the time. It's good. I want to make one comment, though, about pilot shortages, because everybody has mentioned that. Just so, and you may have already heard it or not, I don't know, but it costs $140,000 to train a pilot today to his commercial level of 250 hours. And you really need 500 just to get into the right-hand seat of a commercial aircraft. So children are not going forward and getting pilot's license like we did in the past. And unless there's some help with that aspect of it, you're always going to have a pilot shortage.
Thank you, Mr. Kendall. Okay. And Mr. Benedict, I'll give you the last word. Same question.
Oui. Donc, ben, définitivement, il y a tellement d'endroits dans les régions éloignées d'un point.
Yes, there's so many areas and remote regions where people will not do 14 hours of a flight to go to a destination. If we want our remote and northern regions to be visited, there has to be affordable air access, because we have so many beautiful regions in Quebec, but you cannot get there if you take the car. It simply doesn't work.
Merci beaucoup. Thank you, Mr. Badaway. Next, we have Mr. Strahl. Mr. Strahl, the floor is yours. You have 5 minutes, please.
Thank you very much again, Mr. Chair. My question is regarding the passenger protection regulations, APPR regulations, and I'll probably go back to Mr. Wright for this. Often rural and remote airports might have less technical capacity in terms of being able to allow planes to land in inclement weather, fog, snow, that sort of thing, where there's limited visibility. And I know the airlines have raised concerns about whether or not, if the new proposed APPR regulations that the CTA has proposed come into effect, the result could be simply a choice to reduce services in regions where there's risks of delays or risks of cancellations. Have you looked at those new proposed regulations? Has the Gander Airport responded or provided any feedback on them? And do you share that concern that if the regulations are too onerous, that it will result in actually a loss of service or less service to rural, remote, and northern communities?
Yeah, absolutely. Do share that concern. It's a very delicate balance to protect the needs of consumers, which I think we universally would all agree on. But there may be unintended consequences. And without getting into too much detail, I think one of the demands for time in which a delayed flight has to be recovered by the airline make it very easy for them to axe markets that don't have daily service. It's easy to get another tail to fly a route if you're in Trudeau or if you're at Pearson, but when you're in Moncton, New Brunswick, or Gander, you got to remember most of these shoulder season services are built on non-daily service, where we have carriers flying two to maybe four times a week as they try to build demand and go to daily. So that's crucial. And, you know, we talk a lot about airline profitability. I won't say it in front of the committee here, but sometimes the margins on what airlines make per passenger can be quite shockingly low. And if the penalty regime is too high, it can wipe out months of profitability in a single flight. So again, not against it, but I do think that it needs to be carefully assessed in terms of, you know, what is the impact on air service in rural communities, and furthermore, is it a disincentive to travel? Also keep in mind that any costs borne by the airlines are ultimately going to be handed on in some shape or form to consumers. Thank you.
I did want to also talk to Mr. Kendall about the flight duty hours. You talked about pilot shortages, and you talked about if the capacity, if you have to fly four flights to replace the one jet that no longer can fly into a gravel runway, you need four times the crews. And you talked about $140,000 to train up a pilot, and oftentimes the small rural or regional airlines train up the pilots who are then immediately poached for the more profitable, the bigger airlines, if I can put it that way. So you become almost a free training ground for someone else to poach your pilots. But we've heard as well from again, rural, remote, northern airlines and charter companies, et cetera, that they're having a real difficult time with the flight duty regulations and Transport Canada's lack of flexibility there. Obviously, pilot safety, aircraft safety is number one, but can you talk about the impact that those regulations have had on the ability of northern airlines or northern operators to continue to provide the vital lifeline to northern communities?
I can't talk at length about that. All I can tell you is that my experiences in talking with the people who are operating up there is that with the distances you have to fly, the capacity of the aircraft or the distances that the aircraft is able to fly in itself with a full load of fuel, sometimes it causes layovers. It causes pilots to be, or crews not to be able to go to the next stop. It's you know, where before they would have an extra two or three hours to fly, they would make it to the next site and complete the run. They may have to lay over a day now and do the remainder of the trip. It has caused from what I have heard, it has caused serious issues. There's no question. And with crews being as limited as they are, it's true. And to answer your other question too, by the way, I didn't answer it fully. The last 737-200 will be out of service with Air Inuit next summer. So
thank you very much, Mr. Kendall, and thank you, Mr. Strahl. Next, we have Mr. Fillmore. Mr. Fillmore, the floor is yours. You have 5 minutes, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thanks very much to the witnesses present and online. I'm sorry Mr. Davidson is not here. I just wanted to say to him, we really appreciate his passion on the topic of emissions, and I did feel I needed to remind him that Canada has the third lowest gas tax regime in all the OECD nations, and Canadians are the highest tailpipe emitters in the world, and we all need to do better. But having said that, we heard from the witnesses today about the challenges that we're facing: inflation due to pandemic and war, the cost of capital similarly related, mergers, the shortages of skilled labor, be they pilots or on the ground, foreign ownership within Canada, availability of capital. There are a number of headwinds that the industry is facing right now. Government's certainly doing its part. We want to know more about what else we can be doing. But the standout of the testimony so far for me this morning has been the role of industry partners and what partners can do. Mr. Kendall, we heard you speak about alternate runway materials as an example. I wonder if the witnesses would care to opine on what the role of industry partners might be in helping to solve or face the headwinds that lie ahead in a broad sense. And perhaps Mr. Wright, you mentioned in particular the development of a new aircraft. Could we hear about the role of industry in solving these problems?
Yeah, I think that it's a sort of a universal problem across rural jurisdictions in the world that there is not yet any ready replacement for something in, say, the sub-50 seat range that is intended to service low-density spoke markets and can operate economically. I think a lot of those problems would be solved with the development of that. And, you know, those partnerships with aircraft manufacturers, especially if they're sort of multinational, that is, more than one country is involved in supporting its development and working with industry. I think, you know, some sort of an accelerator fund or something for something clean and efficient that can make those loops in a profitable, environmentally friendly standard would be welcome in almost every small spoke market in the world.
Thank you for that. Mr. Benedict, I wonder if there's any role for, you know, development of destinations by destination partners that can help to ease some of the challenges, if that makes any sense to you.
Yes, as I mentioned a little bit earlier, is that beyond the issue of arriving at destination in remote areas, there's not sufficient volumes. When tourists arrive, they can't rent a car, there aren't any shuttles or buses to actually reach their destination. So we need to develop infrastructures for airports to welcome tourists, but to also have the surrounding services available. To do this is to work with travel agencies and those who organize packages that when the tourists arrived, we can either provide transportation for the tourists or to help the airlines to facilitate that.
The goal being that we want to have full airplanes landing in places with full hotels, so the whole operation is profitable, I understand. I wonder if in the moments that we have left in my time, to stick with an airplane analogy, if we pull up on the stick and rise up above the clouds where the visibility is unlimited, if we look ahead to where this industry is in Canada in 30, 20, 30, 40 years, where do you see us being at that time? I'll just give you one example. I mean, we're hearing about electric airplanes. We're hearing about the possibility of hydrogen-powered airplanes. We had a witness on the study earlier who's involved in ideating about about a future with dirigible airships to help solve some of these problems, although we didn't get any testimony on that. But I just wonder where the witnesses see our industry in Canada in 30 years and what we might be doing now to help get there. And I would open it wide open to anybody who wants to think expansively.
On the dirigible airship side of the house, they will likely be short haul. Mining companies might operate them, that sort of thing. They're slow, so at this point, 70 knots. So you're not going to have one coming up from the south to the north, but perhaps it will be from a hub center where they would take supplies into a short distance, 70 to 100 miles, whatever. And I know Boeing, Lockheed, those companies are all looking at developing those types of aircraft now. And then, of course, in the next 40 years, you're going to have more composite body aircraft flying. And there's going to have to be some method of ensuring that they're safe when they're operating off of the runways that they're using.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Fulmore, and thank you, Mr. Kendall. Prochainement, nous avons Monsieur Lemire. Monsieur Lemire, la parole est à vous. 2 minutes et demie, s'il vous plaît.
Mr. Lemire, you have the floor for 2.5 minutes. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Benedict, one of the big issues for regional airlines, in addition to the cost of service, is to have an adapted schedule. For example, Rouen, Naranda, the schedules have often varied over the past few years. It's almost impossible to come back from Europe without spending a night in Montreal. So that limits international travel to our destination. As well, people like to have a single connection on one ticket to be protected if ever there were a delay or cancellation, which happens quite often, and to have also good prices for international flights from Canada. I'd like to hear you speak about the agreements between carriers, because one of the concerns was to be covered in the case of cancellations, etc., or delays. Is there a way of taking action, perhaps legally or in another means, to ensure that we are facilitating moving from one to another, that is either for the baggages or our connection, to make sure that there are actually more options available on the market, that there's greater competition? Maybe we could speak about Montreal and other regions to make sure that there are no penalties tied to this. We always say that we have to make tourism easier. It's very complicated. If it's complicated for a tourist, the person's going to change your destination. It's going to change the trip. Unfortunately, often it's about the connection. If you have one airline that's providing one route, that's difficult, but perhaps it could work with another. And to facilitate the route, that would contribute to these tourists wanting to visit the regions. Of course, it's difficult from a market point of view to ensure this and to make sure there's collaboration, but I think that's where we have to go if we want to further develop tourism. And of course, it'd be good if the return flight were less expensive in the regions. We're limited by the availability of flights. They have to come back with the same company. It's the same thing for international connections, but these are all innovative solutions that we could put in place to help our regions. And I know perhaps you can't always give a rebate for somebody to take a return ticket, but maybe you could offer a possible return with another airline. Well, we're saying that international tourists often don't have access to the regions. They come to Montreal or Quebec City. They have no other options. There are very few tourists who pick up on those options. Once again, everything is about the price, and that is the number one point that tourists will choose. So if they're penalized because they must go elsewhere, they have to return from the same place. We've simply eliminated that from the calculations. They're going to choose the other option. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And one last question for Mayor Pond to round out the meeting. We've heard from the big airports in Canada who pay rent to the federal government to the tune of some $400 million per year, that they would like that rent either waived or reinvested in airport infrastructure as a way of supporting their operations and driving down costs for users of airports. Of course, that doesn't speak directly to the needs of small airports, especially municipal airports that are owned by the municipality. And I wonder if there might be some sort of similar accommodation provided by the federal government that would make the maintenance of airport infrastructure and the operation of airports easier for municipalities like Prince Rupert, whether it's on the infrastructure side or the operating side, Is there a need for greater federal support?
Yes. I think we need to step back and take a look at the network. We look at these as individual airports, as if any one of them can survive on their own. But every flight has an origin and a destination, and many of them have connection points in between. The big change that took place back when the airline industry deregulated was we got the hub and spoke model. Airlines finally realized that 30-40% of their transcontinental traffic actually started in small communities like Comox or Prince Rupert, or you know, and fed in. We need to think of that network as one, so that the Prince, if Vancouver Airport's got excess money and paying rent, that should be enabling Prince Rupert to continue to operate and Terrace to continue to operate and Smithers to continue to operate, because Vancouver cannot do what it does if there isn't other airports in this. It's a network, and we somehow have stopped thinking of it as a network.
So if I may, Mr. Chair, I'm guessing that's sort of an argument that if the federal government is going to subsidize airports to the tune of $400 million per year, that it should think beyond just the big airports and make some of those monies available to the spoke airports that feed the hubs. Is that what you're saying, Mayor Pond?
Absolutely. The fundamental should be that this is one great big network. Some of these airports are going to be profitable. Some of these airports aren't going to be profitable. But they all are necessary for the entire network to work. And however that money gets transferred back and forth, it is for you guys to work out, but we've got to stop thinking of these as individual airports.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Bacharach, and thank you, Mr. Pond. We'll conclude today with Mr. Strahl. Mr. Strahl, the floor is yours. 5 minutes, sir.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair, and thank you to the witnesses for appearing and giving us your insight. Mr. Chair, I'd actually like to take this time to ask you a question. We had a motion passed by this committee to extend an invitation to Ministers Fraser and Minister Rodriguez to come and appear before the committee to defend or discuss the estimates and the budget. Mr. Fraser appeared with his officials, and we were able to do that. We have not heard from Mr. Rodriguez, as far as I know, and obviously we are running out of dates here before the estimates are reported back, before we have those final votes and before we would have that opportunity. So I'm wondering if Minister Rodriguez has responded to that invitation. Perhaps you could let the committee know, and I would say on behalf of Conservatives, we would be willing to sit for an extra hour or schedule an additional meeting if the timing for our meetings before the House rises for the summer does not allow for it. So perhaps you can let us know, has he responded, and if not, are you willing to re-extend that invitation in the hopes that we can do as we did with Minister Fraser and have those questions.
Thank you, Mr. Strahl. I conferred with our clerk, and we have not received a response back with regards to Minister Rodriguez's presence.
Okay. Would you be willing to reach back out to his office and with that invitation again, and again with the with the knowledge that certainly from our side of the table, we'd be willing to extend hours, meet on a day we don't normally meet, provided that there are resources made available. But I would ask you don't have to respond to it, but I would simply ask that you do re-extend that invitation and perhaps look for offer him more flexibility if he has not responded to the committee that is charged with holding him accountable for the money that is spent on his file. So I'm hopeful that that we have a positive response by the next meeting.
Thank you, Mr. Strahl. Duly noted, and I will work with the clerk to ensure that that is done. Thank you. Before we conclude today, colleagues, if it's okay, I'd like to ask one question to our witnesses that I don't think has been addressed, specifically to Monsieur Benedict. Seeing no objection. Monsieur Benedict, merci encore une fois pour votre présence ici aujourd'hui.
Mr. Benedict, thank you very much for being with us. The program put in place by the government of Quebec, that $500 subsidy for tickets to travel to rural and remote areas, is of great interest to me. I'd like to know this. Is this a program that after 2 years works well? Have we seen an increase in the number of tickets that have been sold to travel to these regions? In your mind, has this delivered the results that you were looking forward to? Thank you for that question. We're very happy with this program. There are some issues, however, that many of the people who buy these tickets is during the holidays. So at that time of year, there is great demand. So we're trying to promote these tickets throughout the entire year to make sure that people buy them ahead of time. And right now, there are only three main airports, the Montreal, Quebec City, and St. Hubert airports offering them. We're working with the government to ensure that this could be expanded to, for example, Gaspésie, and not only to go to urban centers. We want to make sure that there's greater reach. So I think that we've tried to identify the best solutions for Canada. And if it works in Quebec, perhaps it could work across the country. Well, perhaps you or your organization, or does the government of Quebec have statistics in hand to show how much money was invested by the Quebec government that is tied to the amount spent in tourism? Is there a return in investment that is a dollar per dollar amount? Would you have any figures to show that? Because I find that this is a very possibly interesting pilot project, but do we have evidence that it is working? And if so, perhaps as members, we could use this model and apply it to the rest of Canada. Would you have that in hand? Well, the data we have for tourism is that $1 invested, stays here, and rather than being invested in going to Europe or elsewhere, a dollar that we invest stays here in the country. So often we don't calculate that, we don't factor that in, so we're actually inciting people to visit to remote regions, and we also have many Indigenous communities that offer modern tourism infrastructure. So investing to make people stay here is not necessarily so much of a benefit, but it does ensure that people stay here. Do you have any statistics or any facts that show how much the Quebec government has already spent during year one or year two? I believe it's been in place for 2 months. Perhaps you could look at that. And then maybe we could look at perhaps seeing this compared to an increase in tourism in the region.